Good morning. Welcome to Union. We're glad to have each and every one of you here this morning. If you're visiting with us this morning, we want to welcome you. You're an honored guest. We're glad to have you with us this morning. My name is David Craddock. I'm over the men's ministry here. Our pastor, Adam Cook, is out of town this week, so I'm going to be filling in for those of you that are Union members. We're glad to have you back this morning. I want to start off this morning. I'm going to get off track for just a second because of something I just read, and I think Dylan dared on it. There's a couple in the church this morning that's celebrating an anniversary, and I saw that they've been married 13 years. So that's BJ and Amanda have been married 13 years. Is that right? 13. And I got to tell you, I know both of them. They are two very sweet people. They both serve here in the church, and just knowing Benny, 13 years, bless you, Amanda. Bless you. See her? She's shaking her head. Bless you. But we're glad to have each and every one of you with us this morning. We're going to continue with our third week of My Biggest Fear. And so I want to tell you a little bit about what we've done so far in the first week. We talked about my biggest fear is my next step, what your next step is as far as Christ or church, Christianity, what you're going to do, where you're going to go with what you know, what you've learned. Last week we talked a little bit about your fears, what some of your fears might be. And so this week we're going to continue with that, and I got to speak last week, and I got a little constructive criticism, which I'm okay with. I'm fine with that. Somebody came up and said, David, you did a pretty good job, but you're just not as funny as Adam. And I said, okay, I can accept that. So I came with a couple of jokes today, so I want to bring some jokes this morning just to see if I'm doing okay. Okay, so you guys ready for that? What do you call a chicken crossing the road? Poultry in motion. Get it? Yeah. Okay. All right, what do you call a boomerang that doesn't come back? A stick. Uh-huh, right. What do you call cheese that's not yours? Not your cheese, that's right. There you go, thank you. Couple of jokes to get started this morning. How about this? What do you call a Christian who doesn't serve? A contradiction. Ooh, yeah. So I've been doing some studying over the past couple weeks, and I'm going to tell you that my toes are hurting. My toes are really hurting because I stepped on my own toes, and I got big feet. I'm not a small guy either, so it's hurting. So this morning we're going to be talking about the fears of evangelism, and I want to really help you with that. I want you to overcome your fears of reaching out to folks, and we're going to talk about that as we talk about our third week of My Biggest Fears. What are your fears when it comes to evangelism, spreading the word, spreading the gospel? And so I've got a couple of questions first that I want to ask you. Are you, number one, are you afraid to witness? Are you scared to give testimony? Are you afraid to tell people what you know? Number two, are you afraid to disciple? Are you afraid to ask other people to come with you? Or maybe to join a group? Or maybe to teach someone what you know? Maybe you're a Christian, you have been for years. Maybe you know the Bible. Maybe you've studied it, but you're afraid to step out and teach somebody else about what you know. And number three, are you afraid to serve? Are you afraid to step out of your comfort zone and serve other people? And there's lots of different capacities and lots of different ways to serve. And we're going to be talking about that this morning. And evangelism is a big word. And so I want to tell you what it means. It simply means to spread the gospel. It's very easy. Spreading the gospel, spreading the word. Now, we don't have any trouble spreading gossip, but we have trouble spreading the gospel. And I say we. I'm just like any one of you, just a normal guy. But we do. We have a hard time spreading the word. We have a hard time discipling, and we have an even harder time serving. So you say, why should I serve? I don't understand what that's all. I thought that that's what the pastor does. Isn't that what the pastor does? Isn't he the one that invites people to come to church and teaches the classes? And you're in the men's ministry, David. Aren't you the one that's supposed to be doing that? And I saw a little quote this week that, as simple as it is, and it's kind of funny too, but it makes a lot of sense. It says this: shepherds don't make sheep. Sheep make sheep. We are the sheep. We make other sheep. The shepherd doesn't do that. Now, I'm not saying that Adam doesn't invite people. I'm not saying that he doesn't teach. I'm not saying that he doesn't do any of those things, because he does. And our leadership does that. But we are the sheep. God is the shepherd. We have to make other sheep. That's what our responsibility is. And that's how we can help. That's how we serve. So I have a verse this morning that I want to begin with. It's Mark 10:45, and it says this, "For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many." Jesus said this. He's talking to John and James. And John and James come to Jesus and they say, "We want to be with you. We know that you're going somewhere." They didn't understand anything that was about to happen. But they came to him and they said, "When you go to your throne, we want to be on your left and on your right. What do we need to do? Sign us up. We're ready to go." And Jesus says, "I don't think you're ready. I don't think you're ready for the cup that I'm about to drink from." And they're saying, "Oh, yes, we are. Yes, we are." And he says, "Okay, if you want to be with me, this is what you got to do. If you want to be first, if you want to sit next to me on the throne, you need to be last, because the last will be first." And they said, "That doesn't make a lot of sense. We don't understand." And he says, "I came to serve. I came to be a servant, not to be served." Now, you can look at other religions around the world, and they will always show that we are to serve that God. Whatever that God is, they want you to serve them, not the God to serve us. So we've got something greater. We've got something even better than any of them can offer, because he said, "I came to serve." I've got another verse that I want to tell you. This is Jesus talking to the disciples. If you have your Bibles, turn to Acts 1:8. Or if you've got it on your phone or on your app, Acts 1:8. And if you don't have a Bible this morning and you need one, we would love to give you one. We have them free and available at the information desk. But if you've got one this morning, Acts 1:8. There's one very important word that I want you to understand this morning. I want you to circle it or underline it or highlight it as we read it this morning. But Acts 1:8 says this, "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you." When you're saved, when you ask the Lord into your life, it says, "You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all of Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." There's one very, very important word in that verse that I want to point out to you this morning. It's that second will, the second one. It says, "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth." Now, I want to point out something very particular about the way that that reads, and the reason that I want you to circle, and the reason that I want you to underline that word will. And that is, it didn't say that you could be. It didn't say you might be witnesses. It didn't say you could be witnesses. It didn't even say you should be witnesses. It says, "You will be my witnesses. You are my hands and my feet. You will serve others in my name." And the reason that he said it the way that he did, he said it in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria. What he's saying is, you start out in your little area where you are, maybe in your neighborhood, in your community, and then you branch out to, like, I live in Ringgold, for example. Maybe I branch out into Ringgold, and then here we are in Danville, and we're right in the middle of Danville, right in downtown Danville, and we're here for a reason. Do we just stop here, or do we continue to spread it out? Maybe to Pennsylvania County, maybe to Virginia. And then he says, he goes even a step further and says, to all the ends of the earth. So he has called on us to be witnesses for him, each and every one of us. But there's something that we're talking about this morning. We're talking about that fear, your fear. A little later on this morning, I'm going to tell you what my biggest fear is. But right now I ask you, what are you really afraid of? What is your fear from taking that next step? And we talked about some last week. We talked about rejection, and we talked about failure. We talked about not being good enough. And I want you to know something, that the Lord isn't expecting numbers. He's not up there keeping a tally or a count. It's not about a score or anything. I know many of us play sports and very competitive. And you say to yourself, well, I've been doing this a long time. There may be some of you here this morning that have been serving the Lord for 20 years, 30 years. Maybe you've taught classes, been in groups and things. You say, I've only brought one person to Christ or a few people to Christ. Bless you. He's not keeping any counts. It's out of obedience that we do what we do. We serve, we witness, we disciple out of obedience. It's not about the numbers. You're not going to win everyone. It's not up to you. You're not the one that's going to save them. Our Lord is going to save them. So I want to take that fear away from you right now. And I want to give you four ways to overcome your fear of evangelism this morning. And I think once you think about them, you're going to say to yourself, well, I knew that all along, but I want to point them out to you. Number one, I want you to be bold for the Lord. That's a big word, bold. It's just a four-letter word, but it's a big one. I saw someone this week that posted on Facebook, pray boldly. Be bold in prayer this week. I believe in that. I believe in being bold. In our society today, what you will find, one of the big things, one of the big topics in news and around our area is bullying. Some of you recognize that kids are being bullied. Folks are being bullied. I was a fat kid growing up. I'm a fat man now, but I was a fat kid growing up. And I got bullied. You know, they picked on me. They made fun of me. It made me feel bad, made me feel low. And now it's gotten much, much worse. And we're seeing teenagers take their lives, and we're seeing children fighting with one another over this bullying. Now, you say to yourself, well, I would stand up for them. That's not going to happen. It's not going to happen to my child. I'm going to speak up. I'm not going to allow my child to be bullied or pushed around or made fun of or talked to that way. How about a coworker, though? How about someone you go to church with? What if you heard someone saying false things about God? Would you stand up to them? Would you call out someone that's falsely accusing? Someone told a lie on someone else and you knew the truth? You knew that that was not fact? Would you stand up for them? Would you stand up for our Lord? We have to be bold. We have a big God. Amen? We serve a big God. He is powerful. He is much bigger than anything that's in front of us. We've got to be bold in our steps, bold in our words, bold in our actions. Number two, He is our provider. He provides for us. This morning we sang about His strength. Your strength is all I need. I find my strength in You. We find our needs from Him. Many of us in this room can say that we've never really gone without. There's plenty of things that we want that we don't get, but as far as our needs go, we get what we need. He is an awesome provider for us. And in times of need, He will provide. He will provide you with support. He will provide you with encouragement. He will provide you with power, with strength. So we need to remember that. Number three, put others first. This is an easy one. You're probably already doing this in many ways. How many of you will hold the door for somebody? You don't mind doing that, right? You'll hold the door for somebody. How about, have you ever been in the grocery line and you got 100 items in your cart and somebody comes up behind you and they got two? And you just say, hey, you can just step around. Go ahead and get in front of me. You've only got two things. I've got 100 here. Just look. You put somebody else first. So easy, right? So easy putting others first. It's a blessing, really. Now think about how many opportunities you have with what you have to bless someone else. Putting others first. Maybe you've been saving money for a trip or some new clothes or something like that, and then you find out that someone's house has been burned down. Just saw that on the news this week. It was on the front page of the paper. Someone's home, they lost everything. Maybe you look and say, well, I've got some kids about their age. Wonder if I could pass on some clothes. Or wonder if I could just buy them some groceries to help them get through. Put them in a hotel for a night. Put others first. In front of yourself, because remember, we said that the first are the last. We'll put others in front. And the last will be first. And number four, the best of all, is to follow the example of Jesus. He gave us this awesome example to follow of serving others and all the things that He did. Last week, I told a little story. I want to tell you a little bit more about it this morning, about Harlan Sanders. Everybody remember about Colonel Sanders? He came up with Kentucky Fried Chicken, and I was telling the story last week that Colonel Sanders was 65 years old, and he was making chicken in a truck stop diner. And people kept telling him, your chicken is good. You need to do something with that. I don't know, I'm 65. And they said, yeah, we really think that's some good chicken. I think you could go somewhere with that. So he started making phone calls to other restaurant owners and people that can promote his chicken, and he called 1,008 people, and they all said no. And finally, number 1,009 said, yeah, we'll give your chicken a try. He was 65 years old, and he finally took off with the chicken. Of course, as many of you know, KFC, $285 million industry now. An interesting side fact was there was a young high school dropout, kid that didn't have a family. He had been adopted, 16 years old. Colonel Sanders took him in, started to teach him the business, started to tell him what he knew, to get him to understand how it was to serve people and the right way to do business and the right way to serve the customers. So that young man started to take off, and he started to do really, really well. And Colonel Sanders had four chicken restaurants in Ohio that were failing. They were not doing well at all. And he came to this young man and he said, I want you to go to Ohio and I want you to see if you can turn around these four restaurants for me. So this young man by the name of Dave Thomas went to Ohio and started working in those chicken restaurants and those KFCs. And he turned each of them into million-dollar stores. And in 1968, Dave Thomas sold his shares of KFC in 1968 for $1.5 million and started his own little restaurant called Wendy's. Dave Thomas, to his death, would tell you, I told you he was a high school dropout, he would tell you that he didn't have his GED until he was grown, but he had his MBA. Anybody know what an MBA is? Master, Bachelor of Arts or whatever? No, his was mop bucket attitude. He had an MBA. He had a mop bucket attitude. What that meant was he knew that you had to start somewhere. He believed that you could start with a mop and a bucket of water and you could work your way up. And he believed that all of his associates, all the people that he worked with or worked under him should have an MBA. To learn how to serve other people, and that would make them better. And I think he did a pretty good job, would you say? I think he did all right. If you take a look at KFC and look at Wendy's, both are very thriving businesses because they believe in putting their customers first and how to serve people the correct way. In the Bible, I want to give you two examples of buckets, talking about an MBA. If you take a look at Pilate in the time that they were persecuting Jesus, Pilate said, bring me a bucket of water. And in front of all the people, he said, I'm not going to prosecute this man. And he washed his hands and he says, I wash my hands of the blood of this man. It's your responsibility. I put it on you. I'm not taking responsibility of it. In front of everyone, he washed his hands in this bucket. But a little bit later on, as Jesus took his disciples into the upper room, they didn't know that it was about to be their last supper with him. And they ate together, and as they walked the streets, and as they came in, those streets were, of course, made of dirt, and they were very dusty, and they were very dirty. And if it rained any at all, you got mud all over your feet. And Jesus came and took his gown and made it into an apron, a whole lot like the ones that folks wear in the restaurant. And he took them and he took a bucket of water and he called each of his disciples to him and he washed their feet. Because in those days, when you had someone over as a guest in your home, you had a servant that met them at the door that washed their feet off, and it was a pretty low job. But Jesus said, I want to wash the feet of the men that I love. And some of them said, this is ridiculous. You can't do it. We should be washing your feet. Why are you washing ours? And again, I remind you that the last will be first. You see, he put others first. He put his disciples first. He showed them his love for them by serving them. Now, I don't know about you. I wouldn't want anybody washing my feet. And especially not dirty and muddy. But he got them down and he used that gown just like an apron and he washed their feet off. That's how he showed us his example of service. And again, some of you will say, well, that was Jesus. That's not me. Or I'm not cut out to do like that. I don't think that that's me. I'm not a good person to be picked to do service. Somebody else will do it. Why choose me? Somebody else will. That other folks know how to do that thing. And I found this poem I wanted to read to you about somebody else. There's a clever young guy named Somebody Else. There's nothing this guy can't do. He's busy from morning till way late at night, just filling in for you. You're asked to do this and you're asked to do that, and what is your reply? Get somebody else to do that job, because he'll do it much better than I. So much to do in this weary old world, so much and the workers so few. And somebody else, all weary and worn, is still filling in for you. Somebody else will do it. The Bible says very plainly that the harvest is great, but the laborers are few. We need to step up. We need to step out. We need to step forward. We need to be witnesses. We need to be disciples. Each and every one of you here has a gift. Each and every one of you here has a talent, has an ability, has something that you can do to serve other people. I cannot sing. I cannot play an instrument. I bless those that can. I'm thankful. Our worship team played at a concert on yesterday. Thank God for them. Because I can play the radio and a CD player, and that's about it. That's about as good as it gets. And some of you are going, yeah. My wife is back there going, yes, absolutely, he cannot. But I have the ability to speak. God's given me this gift. And I'm going to tell you something. As I come out here each morning, each time that I get the opportunity to speak to you, when I'm sitting over in that little corner, I just pray that God speaks through me. I've just got a big mouth. That's all it is. Amen? Amen. Yeah, BJ's going, amen, brother. But I just allow God to use me, because this is what I can do. But I'm not good. I'm not a mechanic. I can't play a guitar. I'm not an electrician. There's plenty of things that I cannot do. I just use the ability and the gifts that he's given to me. And I want you to know that he's given abilities and gifts to you too. In 1 Peter 4:10, it says this: each of you should use whatever gift you have received to serve others as faithful stewards of God's grace in its various forms. If you can sing, sing to the Lord. If you can work on cars, do it for the Lord. Whatever you can do, there's so many different ways that you can serve. There's so many things that you can do if you'll just use your gifts. And I want you to know something. There's three really important things I want you to understand about the gift that you've been given. Whether it's singing, whether it's working, whether it's finances, whatever the case may be, I want you to know this. Your gifts are not about you. Your leadership is not about you. Your purpose is not about you. You see, we're born selfish. We have a selfish nature about us. It's part of our sin nature. If you take a look at a child, when you put two little children together and they've got toys, what's going to happen? One of them plays with the other one. They'll grab it, snatch it, right? They don't want to share. It's that selfish nature. What's one of the first words kids ever learn? Mine. 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 Because we're selfish. We don't want to share. And as adults, it carries over. I worked hard for this money. I worked hard for this life. I worked hard for all of these things. It's mine. It's not about you. You were saved to serve. You are mobile for ministry. It's not about you. A life of significance is about serving those who need your gifts. They need your leadership. They need your purpose. Because it's not about you. So I want to ask you this morning, what are you waiting for? What's holding you back? We've talked this morning about rejection. We've talked this morning about failure. We've talked about what you have and you don't have. You can distinguish the difference. I want to give you some things that you can do this morning. Some simple steps to overcome your fear of evangelism. Number one, serve whenever you can. Serve whenever you can. We'll make time for soccer games. I'm guilty of it too. We'll make time for soccer games and for competitions. We'll make time for our favorite TV shows. But we won't make time to come to a group. We won't make time to bring our kids to a youth group. We'll take them anywhere else, but we won't do it. Serve whenever you can. There's always a need for volunteers. When the church asks, when it sends out an email or puts a post on, we need volunteers, that's you. That's you and me. I know this is hard to believe, but that coffee doesn't come out of a tap. Somebody has to make the coffee. And those cookies don't bake themselves. I sure wish they did. I'd be bigger than I am now. This church doesn't clean itself. Those groups that meet don't meet alone. Serve whenever you can. Serve wherever you can. So Jesus said, "You will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria." And again, what he was saying was, you don't just have to do it here, do it out. Spread out. There's all kinds of other ministries. We had a ministry that just met at the Danville House yesterday. We've got a ministry that goes to the nursing homes. Maybe there's a community that you're in or neighborhood that you're in that needs you to go out and be the witness. Where can you be of service at? And lastly, do whatever it takes. And I want to tell you the good news about these four things. I want to share something with you that I think is extremely important. You will go out and you will think to yourself that you're going to go out and be a blessing to somebody else. And what you'll end up finding out is that you will end up being the one that gets blessed. I remember several years ago, I had a youth pastor friend of mine that said, "I'm going up to the hospital, I'm going to do some visitation." And he asked me, "You want to come with me?" And I said, "Yeah, I've got the day off, so I'd love to come up there." And so we went up to see this older lady. She was very fragile. She was very old. And from what I had understood and what he had told me, she was pretty much on her deathbed. She was at the hospital, and they were making her comfortable, and she was really old. And we went up there, and we thought that we were going to talk to her, and we thought we were going to pray with her, and we thought we were going to go up and be a blessing. And we got up there, and we spent hours talking to her. She had lived through the Depression. She had seen her husband pass, and I think even her children. She was an older lady, and here she was on her deathbed, and all she could do was praise God. And I left there thinking, I came up here to be the blessing. She ended up blessing me. And I think that's what you'll find as you step out to serve, as you step out to disciple and to witness to other folks and to other people, is that it won't just be about the blessing that you have for them, but the blessing they have for you. And I want you to know something. Serve on the prayer team here, and we meet every Sunday morning at 8 o'clock. And we pray over the requests by name, all of them that come in. And if you knew some of the needs that were in this church, if you knew some of the ways that you could simply serve, it would blow you away. There's a lot of needs. There's a lot of people hurting. Your service, your discipleship, your ministry could be just prayer. I went to a church where they had a little lady that wasn't able to get out much, and what she did, she bought a box of cards, and every time someone was sick, or someone had a birthday, or someone had lost a loved one or something, she had a card ministry. She would sit down and write those folks a card, and that was her ministry, and it was an awesome one. Maybe that's something that you can do. Maybe you can help clean the church. You don't have to do it every week. Maybe you have a passion for young people. Maybe you have a testimony that they need to hear. Maybe you could share. Maybe you're good at lighting, electricity. Maybe you could help do some upgrades. Or maybe you could build a set of steps. Or maybe you could reach out to a neighbor who's in need. Buy some groceries for somebody. What are the ways that you can serve? What are some of the things that you can do? How are you going to step out and step up? This morning, I have one last bit of scripture that I want to read, and I want to read it straight from the Bible. And I didn't have them to put it on the screen because I want you just to listen, because I feel like it's really important. It's from Matthew 25, and I just want you to listen to this. Matthew 25, starting in verse 31, it says this: "When the Son of Man comes in His glory, and all the angels with Him, He will sit on His glorious throne. And all the nations will be gathered before Him, and He will separate the people one from another, as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And He will put His sheep on His right, and the goats on the left. And then the King will say to those on the right, 'Come, you who are blessed by my Father, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. I needed clothes, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you looked after me. I was in prison, and you came to visit me.' And then the righteous will answer him, 'Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you? Or thirsty and gave you something to drink? When did we see you a stranger and invite you in, or need clothes and clothe you? When did we see you sick or in prison or go to visit you?' And the King will reply, 'Truly I tell you, whatever you did for one of the least of these, you did for me.' And then he will say to those on his left, 'Depart from me, you who are cursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry and you gave me nothing to eat. I was thirsty and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger and you didn't invite me in. I needed clothes and you didn't clothe me. I was sick and in prison and you didn't look after me.' And they will answer, 'Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or needing clothes or sick or in prison and didn't help you?' And he will reply, 'Truly I tell you, whatever you did not do for the least of these, you did not do for me.'" I want to tell you my biggest fear this morning. My biggest fear is that I don't share the gospel with somebody who really needs it. That I don't show Christ through me, through my actions, through my words. I fear for the lives of my children. That I don't bring them up so that they know the Lord like they should. That the people that work with me, or the people that hang out with me, the people that know me, that they won't know God through me, through Lord through me. That's my biggest fear. I strive to do the best that I can. Oftentimes I fail. But I believe in service. I believe in serving others. I believe in discipleship and witnessing. I want to tell you why. Just what I've seen in this church in the past month, I saw a lady healed because somebody went and prayed with her. I saw an 11-year-old give their life to Christ right out here in the hallway because somebody served her. I saw a man who was running from God who now runs to God because he went to a group and somebody served him. I've seen families that were broken apart come back together again because of service. I saw a man and his daughter get baptized together because somebody wasn't afraid to invite him to come to church. You can do all of those things. It's not hard to reach out, to serve, to love people. Save people, serve people. You were saved to serve. I challenge you this morning to serve one another, to love one another as He has loved us, to reach out to those that are needing. It's a lot of people that are in need. This is a dark world. Outside of these doors, don't let it fool you. It's a dark world. We need to be a light. Pray that He will make you bright. Pray with me. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for this day and for this opportunity to worship you, Lord. I thank you for the chance to speak. Father, I thank you that you speak through me. These are your words, not mine. Father, I thank you that you have given us all gifts and abilities that we can reach out and serve other people. Father, I pray that you would encourage us. You would encourage our steps. Father, that you would give us the strength to do that. Father, that we would overcome our fears. Father, that you would fill us with love that we might reach out and touch someone that needs it so badly. Father, I thank you for all of those who came out tonight. Father, may we be soldiers in your army. Father, may we go out and fight against the darkness, be a light in a dark world. Father, use us. Use us in whatever capacity you need us to. Father, whether it's making coffee or cleaning a church or leading a group or speaking up in our own families. Father, I thank you for allowing us to serve you just as you served us. Father, I thank you for your words of truth. May they touch our hearts this morning. Father, help us to go out and tell someone about Jesus. It's in his name I ask this. Amen.
You guys stand with us and worship.